Back in the 90s, when Michael Eisner was in charge, a lot of Disney projects were motivated primarily by spite. Most famously, California Adventure being built around the idea of recreating famous sites from around the state to spite the rest of California for drawing tourists away from Disneyland. Before that, a similar concept was tested on the East Coast. Although there weren't as many famous sites to replicate from Florida aside from Swamplands and, of course, the guy who sells Gator Jerky out of the back of his pickup truck on Sunday afternoons under an overpass near Disney Springs, but Eisner did notice that out-of-state visitors were leaving the Disney bubble to see racing. After all, the Daytona Speedway in Florida is one of the most famous tracks in the world, and Disney wanted a piece of that action. Fortunately, at the same time, someone else motivated by spite was working on a new project and needed partners. The Indy Racing League, founded by Tony George, was created with the intention to make IndyCar racing cheaper and more accessible compared to the well-established CART, but some say it was really just about Tony not wanting to play by someone else's rules. He wasn't just some random guy with a dream. Tony was the owner of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, the home of the Indy 500, so he had some real weight behind him, but most of the big name talent was with Cart, so Tony needed a new big name. A name like Mickey Mouse. The first ever race for the Indy Racing League happened in 1996 at the new Walt Disney World Speedway. The speedway was built on the edge of the Magic Kingdom parking lot, a location that allowed them to save on infrastructure costs. Another way to keep costs down was to just not build anything other than the road itself. The stands for audiences, garages for the racers, and even bathrooms were all temporary structures set up when needed and torn down when they want. In honor of the iconic Indianapolis Motor Speedway's nickname, the Brickyard, and the Walt Disney World Speedway's rodent owner, the new course was unofficially dubbed the Mickeyard. For a while, the speedway seemed to be a big success, and the location in Florida made it accessible year-round compared to tracks up north, which often had to close for the winter. But over time, the issues with the location and design began to become apparent. Setting up and tearing down the temporary facilities became increasingly expensive and annoying. The demand for parking at the Magic Kingdom rose as the crowds at the park grew, leading to more and more operational difficulties. And ultimately, the demands of a growing racing league and the demands of a growing theme park simply were at odds with each other. This came to a head in 2001 around disagreements over when to schedule the first race of the season to avoid being too early in the year or too close to the Super Bowl in Tampa. The contracts were not renewed, and that was the end of professional racing at Walt Disney World. The IRL went on for many more successful years, but the split from Cart hurt both leagues and caused interest in Indy racing in general to plummet, thereby helping to facilitate the rise in stock car racing to fill the void. Something some say never would have happened if the Disney name and by extension broadcasting rights on ABC hadn't helped to legitimize the IRL. So the Walt Disney World Speedway arguably, accidentally, led to the NASCAR and stock car racing boom of the 2000s. But what happened to the Speedway once the racing stopped? Well, that's a story for another time. If you want to find out what happened next, make sure you subscribe so you don't miss part 2.
Or they could just Google it. I mean, it's 2021, all the information in the world is accessible within like 5 minutes. They really don't need me. Oh crap, my mic's still on.
Subscribe, please.